Hello and welcome to the Trash Talk Podcast. I am your host JJ, and that with me there is Sergey, as you've probably already seen because we now have lower thirds. I made lower thirds.
Yeah, pretty fancy actually.
Yeah. I didn't want to mention them last time because I kind of sort of hadn't made them by the time we recorded it. So, but I like how they turned out.
Pretty good.
Because when I redesigned the thumbnail, I had to take off the Golden Gate Bridge, and I was like, huh. And then I was like, I don't know how I want to do the lower thirds. I was thinking, like, the wood paneling that we have on the channel banner, or maybe the more metallic look like the previous channel banner that I showed you in last episode. Sorry, there was a fly there.
Yeah.
Or maybe, well the metallic banner from the, or that was also on the old info, on the old intro kind of thing. None of those felt right. Like, all those looked a bit off. Like, I couldn't get it to be in a way that I liked. And then I was like, the Golden Gate Bridge, let's try that. I didn't have a lot of hope, but then like I blurred it a little bit, I put the text over it, and it kind of worked.
It looks really, really good.
Thank you.
I really do like that. I probably wouldn't have come up with that.
I mean, it was mostly because I realized that if I wanted to make custom thumbnails for every episode, I would need some space to actually put whatever is relevant to the episode. So I had to remove the background image. I could keep the microphone I knew, and I could keep the text that says Trash Talk Podcast, so I made it a bit smaller. Actually, it used to only say Trash Talk, but I made it a bit smaller, and I made it a bit more readable. But the background image had to go.
Yeah.
And so I was like, huh, it's kind of sad. It's kind of been there from the get-go.
The readability part is really big on
yeah.
that one.
I mean, the event one had two problems. I didn't really like the text projection, and also the contrast was a bit too low to the background. So it was actually kind of hard because originally I was going to outline the text that we had, but because of how it's stylized, it doesn't really work with the outlining that well because it'll always kind of look weird. Because there's like little bits in there that aren't white, and so you either have an outline in there as well, which looks weird, or you don't outline that part and it still looks weird.
Yeah.
But luckily, we had a lot of contrast between the background and the color, so because it's relatively dark, it works, I think. But that is not what we're talking about today, if you've seen the title, and possibly the thumbnail. I mean, oh god, what am I going to put? I guess we're just going to put GLaDOS there or something. We'll see. Like, how do you represent AI?
Terminator. Like, the go-to thing to represent AI.
Yeah, they are all gonna kill us. That is true.
Well, most likely, at least.
Maybe Terminator makes more sense. I always find it kind of funny when YouTubers discuss ideas for the thumbnail during the video, or like the title as well, because by the time you're clicking it, you already know what it's gonna be, right? So, at the time you're watching this, you know what it is, but me at the time of recording this, I have no idea. But yeah, as we said, AI is going to kill us, and that's the topic today. Santé.
Okay.
Okay, listen, right? That was just a coincidence, but I happen to have had that here, and yeah, anyways. This seems like it's more up your alley than mine, so I'm going to let you start. What do you want to talk about AI-wise?
Probably. I mean, we have a few topic outlines for this, so I'm probably going to start with the first bullet point, which is different types of AI and automation.
So, okay, what different types of AI and automation are there?
So, yeah, like the types of AI that we have today already. First, I personally wouldn't even call that AI, just some basic script that runs over and over, like car manufacturers or generally in most production halls. The automation, the robot arms that just do one basic motion over and over again.
Yes.
Then we have the specialized AI that I would actually call AI, which is usually let's split that down even more. Actually, we have the type that is just brute force, where we just try out as many different possibilities as possible.
Yes.
Which works well for certain games, like, for example, chess.
Oh, yeah.
Like, everyone's heard of Deep Blue.
Well, but didn't a different type of AI beat the best traditional chess computer? Didn't, it something, Wolfram Alpha? No, that's not the one. Which one am I thinking of?
AlphaZero.
AlphaZero. Why do you all name your AI so similarly? AlphaZero. Yeah, that one.
Yes, this one is the other kind of specialized AI, which is based on a neural network.
Yes.
That just has a lot, and I mean like really a lot of training data.
Yeah,
so just basically learns from connections within this training data.
Right?
Yes.
Just because I know that a lot of people who watch this will have heard like some of the terminology, but not all of it. So, you know, it's oftentimes for like, I feel like machine learning is a term that's more commonly used. So just want to make this crystal clear for everyone.
Yeah, probably. AI is probably the general thing, and machine learning is a subset of AI.
But you were saying like with AlphaZero that specifically is machine learning.
Yes. So in the case of AlphaZero, it started out just knowing the rules of chess. It knew nothing else, like literally nothing, and just from playing against itself and steadily improving. In the span of 4 hours, because it ran like a couple billion simulations in those 4 hours, so time is kind of relevant here.
Yeah.
It learned to play chess at a super high level, where it could beat the, at that time, most advanced conventional chess computer or chess engine.
Yeah.
Rather.
It, I mean, in a way that makes sense, right? Especially, I feel like chess is, in a way, very simple, right? Where like, sure, like, it's not like a human can very easily learn it, but there's only so many moves you can make at any given point. And so, A, that makes it relatively easy to brute force if you're a computer, but also, since you are operating within a very small set of parameters, I think this is kind of a perfect thing for machine learning, because humans can learn chess very well. And it's kind of the same as with the AI, right? You just play it a lot. I mean, sure, there's like some theory lessons and whatnot, but in theory, you could learn chess just from playing it a lot. And an AI is going to be able to play chess more in a couple of hours than you can in your lifetime.
This is true. Well, at least depending on what servers it's trained on.
I mean, okay, sure.
But yeah.
But I mean, I feel like that's one of the big advantages of AI is just the fact that it can do stuff at a speed that no human can. Because you have insane amounts of processing power that you can specifically dedicate to it. It's hard to say how much processing power the human brain has. Like, it pretty much, like, every time our technology advances, our estimates get higher. Because at some point people are like, oh, the human brain can probably have... So, like, a gigabyte of information! And, like, at the time there was, like, a lot, and, like, now we're like, oh, that's ridiculous! Right? Like...
yeah.
And so, a lot of the estimates about the human brain are just like, well, I'm sure it's a lot! And it's like, and then they just say a number that seems high, but then, as technology advances, we're like, actually, maybe a bit more.
Yes. So, basically, what you're saying is our estimates are getting more and more precise.
I mean, yes, but they're more just getting higher as well. I mean, since...
Yeah.
I don't even like a lot of those estimates because we just don't know, right? Like, we have no way of knowing that precisely.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, a human brain could probably outsmart a lot of those AIs, maybe not the ones that are based on, like, actual numbers of computers. But it's possible that a single human brain could be better than a supercomputer. It's just that also, a human brain has to worry about a lot of things at once.
A supercomputer runs only like one program at a time.
Yeah.
Doesn't care for seeing things, processing the things it sees.
I mean, yeah.
Processing the sound it hears. checking that all the organs work and like keeping balance, and the list goes on and on.
I was about to say, like, let's just think about breathing, right? True. You're probably most of the time not thinking about breathing. Breathing is fun because you can both do it consciously and unconsciously, or subconsciously rather.
Mm-hmm.
It's like one of the only things that you can do in both ways. I think it's the only physical thing you can do in both ways. But it's like, whether you're doing it consciously or subconsciously, it's still your brain doing it.
Yeah. Which is pretty amazing.
Also, something I wanted to bring up when you talked about different types of AI. I know we're not technically all the way there yet because we just talked about machine learning, basically. But
yes,
I've heard something interesting said where someone said that AI is basically just very advanced computing technology that is usually slightly beyond what we can do. Because a lot of the stuff that we these days just consider basic algorithms would have been considered AI maybe in the past. There's now people that say that, oh, this is not real AI, this is just machine learning. It's like, well, yeah, but that's a form of AI. And whether or not you consider a form of AI really just depends on your definitions. And so, before machine learning was really a thing, everyone was considered that AI. Nowadays, some people are like, nah, that's a real AI. And that's just kind of like,
Try doing that with a bunch of if statements.
I mean, yes. And I can see how like drawing the line right below machine learning makes sense, because machine learning seems fundamentally different from a lot of other programming things, because essentially this is the first time that you are not telling the computer what to do. I mean, not precisely. You're telling it what is the goal and what are the methods you can use to get there, and it'll just figure it out.
So, like, you can't really, like you said, you can't really tell what to do. And for a long time, we didn't even understand how it got there to the result it got.
That's the best part, right?
Like, which is the fun part.
Like, so we kind of made a computer do this. Oh, how did you do it? Don't you just care about the fact that it works?
True. there's also a funny story, which I don't know if it's true, actually, before I tell it. I think it's important to say that, but I don't remember which company. I think it was Google, because usually it's Google. Had two AIs, well, three AIs, set up in a test environment where two AIs should communicate with each other privately, in secret, and the third AI would have access to the information that they send to each other and would try to listen in on it.
Okay.
And over time, the first two AIs that had to talk to each other in secret developed an encryption algorithm that even the researchers themselves couldn't crack for a while, which was kind of scary.
I mean, to be fair, we have research. We have encryption algorithms that we can't crack, right? So
yes.
It's like, eh. But like, I mean, that's how SSH keys work, right? Like, you need some very complicated math, and you basically just still kind of have to brute force it over like millions of possibilities to try to crack the keys. But if you have the keys, it's very easy to encrypt and decrypt it.
Yes.
So I
mean, in this case, it's just two AIs that out of nowhere developed an encryption algorithm. And you don't really know what they're doing. Talking about anything.
Well, as I said,
theoretically,
they will kill us.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess, were they like told to try to keep their information secret, or?
Yes. That that was the goal of the experiment.
Because it would be kind of weird if they just, like, if they had no reason to give the information private, but they still did. Like, oh yeah, you just send messages back and forth, like, that's all you do. And then the other one, and then you tell the third one, like, listen to it, and all of a sudden it's like, wait, they're encrypting their stuff, what's happening here? Because that would, that, if they had no reason to encrypt it, and then they still did, that would be weird.
That would be even scarier. Yes, I do agree with that.
Because then it seems like, almost like they're making decisions on their own. Which is, once they start making decisions beyond their parameters, is probably when it gets really worrying. Which kind of brings us into the most important kind of AI, really, which is generalized artificial intelligence.
Yes.
They're like us, but
that was a artificial. Smooth transition to that.
I try my best.
But yeah, generalized AI is basically just a step up from specialized AI, where it can perform a multitude of tasks, not only the ones that it was trained for.
Yeah.
The best example one would be humans. Humans are basically just generalized AIs.
We are, okay.
They can perform a lot of different things.
See, I'll give you generalized. I'll give you intelligence. We're going to have to talk about artificial here for a second.
Man, what's the definition of artificial?
I think it's man-made. Okay, so that's, by the way, also a thing. I think actually we have that in our list of things to talk about at some point, maybe. But the difference between nature and something that's artificial is kind of arbitrary. Or, like, what is natural and what is artificial? Like, is technology the opposite of nature? Like, the difference between something being artificial and natural is generally considered to be whether it was made by humans. But if something made by humans is not part of nature, then that would suggest that humans are a part of nature. Which doesn't make sense, since we evolve from other natural organisms. So, in other words, saying that something that we do is not natural is really a very limited way of looking at things. So, in that way, you could argue that AI is also just a natural intelligence. It's just that instead of being facilitated by biochemistry, they're facilitated by us, who in turn are facilitated by biochemistry. I either didn't drink enough or too much of this. I'm usually fine when it comes to talking. I trip over myself sometimes, but that's just a general thing.
True. I can't confirm.
So, yeah, I mean, I think that humans are a good example of generalized intelligence. I just don't think we're artificial.
Okay. Minor discrepancy in there, in that example.
Fair.
But yeah. Generalized AI, well, I don't know, like, I don't have a better example than humans.
Terminators.
Or maybe some smarter animals. Not entirely sure. Terminator might be... Well, Terminator, I think, is like a step in between this one and the higher one.
So, I mean, Terminators themselves, I guess, are just drones, right? It would be the... What is it? The intelligence that controls them. I forget what that's name is. Something Sky, right?
Skynet!
Hey, see? That's called synergy right there.
Yeah.
Skynet, right? Like, that's a generalized AI, isn't it?
Probably not. I think Skynet is a step above a generalized AI.
Okay, Sergey, what comes above generalized AI?
There comes super intelligent AI, I think, is the I mean, think that's how it's called.
It's arguably still generalized, but okay. Yeah, I think that is when they can evolve themselves to become even smarter than they already are, right?
Yes.
And
super intelligent AI is basically generalized AI on steroids.
Yeah.
Can do everything that we can do, but much, much faster and a lot better.
Yeah, and that is the point also where we call it the singularity, because we cannot possibly posit what comes after it. So a singularity, generally speaking, in science, is just something that we can't really look past. That is why black holes are called singularities, because we do not know what's at the center of a black hole. It's all the mass that is absorbed, but like we kind of don't understand it fully, and it's kind of the same thing with AI. Like, if AI gets too advanced, we just don't know what it's gonna be able to do, because it's gonna be intelligent to a point where it can become more intelligent, and once it surpasses our intelligence, it should theoretically be able to indefinitely grow and become basically the most intelligent thing in existence, and we just don't know what it's gonna do because we can't conceive it.
Yeah. Though, about the definition of a singularity, I think it's more related to that
singularity, let me guess, it's going to lead you into a black hole. Mathematical singularity is a point at which a given mathematical object is not defined or not well behaved. That works.
Yeah.
Singularity in system theory is in dynamical and social systems a context in which a small change can cause a large effect. That's probably not it. Gravitational singularity is black holes. A Penrose-Hawking singularity, blah blah blah, I think it's also about black holes. Prandtl-Glauert singularity is the point at which a sudden drop in air pressure occurs. That's also not it. Singularity in a climate context is a weather phenomenon associated with a specific calendar date. And the Van Hoof singularity is in the density of states of a material. Okay, singularity operating system is an operating system developed by Microsoft. Okay, that's not really interesting. Mechanical singularity is a position or configuration of a mechanism or a machine where the subsequent behavior cannot be predicted. That's the one!
Okay, well. Then the definition I had in my mind was wrong, apparently.
Evidently, there's a bunch of definitions.
That's why we do that.
A technological singularity is a hypothetical moment in time when any physically conceivable level of technological advancement is attained instantaneously. That is probably the one you had in mind. Which both kind of work here.
Not entirely. I was talking about when all vectors in a system point towards a single point. Or a single direction, like in this point towards more intelligence.
Let's see, mathematics. Mathematical singularity, geometry, maybe? Singular point of curve? No, singular point of algebraic variety, irrational singularity. Essential singularity in complex analysis, singularity in near function, singularity is not singularity explicit. The concept is a point in which a function is not defined, but. I'm just looking at the Wikipedia, doesn't mean
they're kind of similar. Yeah.
Funnily enough, Wikipedia lists singularity in parentheses software as a container technology that does not require root permission to run. So once again, that's just the name of software.
Nice.
So yeah, and apparently Microsoft made an operating system called Singularity. So that is written in managed code, which makes me worry about other operating systems.
Yeah.
I mean, there's also multiple films and television series, there is books, there is albums and songs, there is a person that uses it as a stage name, there's video games, and there's organizations. There's Singularity University, a California benefit corporation, part university, part think tank, part business incubator, based on Ray Kurzweil's theory of technological singularity. And there is the Machine Intelligence Research Institute, formerly the Singularity Institute of Artificial Intelligence. And the Singularity Summit is its annual conference. And see also singular disambiguation. which has nothing to do with this. That is just grammar stuff. Or possibly other things. I'm not actually going to click on it, but... Okay, singularity means different things, but I kind of like the idea that we still don't know perfectly about black holes and we don't perfectly know about AI.
Yeah.
So the idea that both of those, at the end of the day, do surpass our knowledge is kind of still fitting that they have the same name. Even though, evidently, that's not entirely the reason of why they have the same name. Maybe it is. Maybe the mechanical singularity was named after the black hole. I don't know.
I don't actually know.
That
might be a topic for another day.
I mean, AI was also saying, I don't think we can look that up on the spot, because that seems like a more complicated topic to investigate. Any other types of AI that we want to talk about?
I think I covered most of them, if not all of them.
I mean, yeah, specialized, generalized.
At least in general shelves.
Yeah, generally, yeah.
That we put them in.
The three that we mentioned in specialized, generalized, and superintelligence are the ones that people talk about the most.
Yeah.
So, I guess that brings up the question. We kind of joked about AI killing us in the future, but I guess the very broad question is AI a good thing or a bad thing?
Oh boy. As with most technological things, I don't think it's either of them.
Okay, so I guess
I perceive AI, at least in the state it's now, purely as a tool.
Yeah.
That we can do good and bad things with.
I definitely agree with that. We kind of talked at one point, I think a couple months ago at this point, about deepfakes and how those can be used for good and bad. So deepfake, of course, is also a machine learning based algorithm. So this could kind of, a lot of the stuff we said that then can be extrapolated onto AI in general, right? It can be used to do a lot of scary things. It can be used to then also detect those scary things and counteract them. And as with anything, it just really depends on how you use it. It also ties into the debates we had about was it the internet in general or was it social media or something, like how, like, you know, this could be a good thing, but it also has negative impacts, and it really depends on how you use it.
Yeah. True.
This might be a good point to, this is going to be our main topic today, but we are going to have a fact and a halftime show, and I feel like this is a good point to, before we talk about the implications of more intelligent levels of AI, where it's not just a tool, that could be after the halftime show. In which case, Sergey, what was your fact of the week?
My fact of the week is... Well, actually, let me first... Okay, now, you do like The Lord of the Rings, right?
I mean, I've seen the movies and I kind of read part of the books. I mean, I like the movies.
So you do at least enjoy it, right?
Yeah.
Did you know that there are multiple adaptations of the first book?
I mean, there's the movies and there's the cartoon show.
Okay, more than that.
No, I did not.
So apparently, the Russians, or at that point in time, the Soviets, also made a movie adaptation of the first book of The Lord of the Rings. It was aired on TV in 1991. And for a long time, everyone thought that it was just lost to time because no one backed it up.
Okay.
And they didn't have archives of that stuff.
Yeah.
But, like, slightly over a month ago, one of the television broadcasters that kind of emerged from that old studio, that old broadcasting service, I don't know, channel thingy, actually did find backups of those, and it uploaded them to YouTube for everyone to watch.
Wow.
Yes. They even added, actually, I don't know if it was them or someone else, but they even have English subtitles, so you can go and watch that right now.
Dare I put an info card up there?
Yeah.
Yeah, that is very interesting. I mean, from what I understand, the Russians and possibly the Soviets as well generally have a slightly different approach to copyright law as the rest of the world. So, from what I understand, there's a lot of wacky Russian versions of things.
Yeah.
That might not necessarily go perfectly in line with what you would expect, so.
And this one isn't only wacky, it's also low budget as heck.
Those were.
So it might be even funnier.
Exactly the two keywords I was expecting, wacky and low budget, yeah. I think there was also a Russian propaganda film that was partially based on Harry Potter. Well, it was based on Harry Potter, but also not really. That was also really wacky.
I haven't heard of that.
I'm only tangentially aware of it. Well, I saw a video about it, but I couldn't really tell you that much about it, honestly. It had very little to do with the actual plot of Harry Potter, but it was kind of still
could imagine
Harry Potter and had a character called Harry Potter or something. My fact of the week that I just wrote down, so I don't know why I'm looking this up, is that something that I found out recently, today, because, well, I was searching for facts, is that apparently the country of Mexico owns all of its own beaches, as in they're all federally owned. There's no private beaches in Mexico, which isn't like hugely surprising, but it's kind of interesting because generally most countries in our capitalist society do allow or do sell parts of their properties to individuals, you know, and individuals and companies. And so private beaches are generally a thing that exists in a lot of places, but apparently not in Mexico. They're all public. So, you know, popular tourist destination, if you ever want to go to Mexico, the beaches are all public. You can just go there.
Nice.
So, just another way in which Mexico is superior to the United States. Yes, I said it.
Yeah.
I mean, listen, right? I like ragging on the US. They deserve it. For the halftime show, I believe we said we wanted to play Google Feud, which I have definitely prepared, so I'm gonna just quickly click around a little bit here, and then I'm gonna move over to actually showing you my screen, because, you know, we're playing Google Feud.
Do the computer magic thing.
I mean, I did the computer magic thing. Listen, right? We're here. So, okay. Do we want to play?
Yeah.
Culture, people, names, or questions?
Oh man, I don't know. It still low-key just bugs choose me. Something.
It still low-key bugs me that names and people are both in there because they seem very similar. Since we are both very cultured, I'm gonna go with culture. Okay, so okay, catch up is.
Boy.
Red.
I can't think of anything.
It's red, isn't it?
But would people search for that?
Only one way to find out. No, they do not. Well, at least not the top 10. It's already kind of weird because that phrase is a question, and there is the word "is" in there, so. Nutritious.
Tasty? How about healthy?
By the way, no, it's not. There's a lot of sugar in there.
Yeah, no. Yes, I know.
No, I'm speaking to the audience. Oh, a smoothie.
Ooh, I like that.
Whoops, that is not the... There we go, smoothie. Second one! Yes!
Nice.
Because a smoothie is a fruit or vegetable that is just basically blended into something drinkable. So technically, by definition, ketchup is a smoothie. And I believe, because there is sugar added to it, it's also a sports drink, isn't it? You know, like Gatorade.
I don't know.
Should I try that?
If you want to.
I don't do sports drink. Hey! Got it!
What?
Got it! It's a meme!
Man, what the heck?
what was the thing about was it about ketchup the Sergey, the D&D stats? Like, strength is being able to crush a tomato? Like that whole thing? Intelligence is knowing that the tomato is a sports drink. Charisma is being able to sell it or something. Wasn't there a whole thing about that?
Wisdom is not to put it in a salad. No, not a salad. Fruit salad.
Right. Or something like that. Right. Intelligence is to know that tomato is a fruit. Wisdom is to not put it in a fruit salad. Yeah. Exactly. Wasn't there something about salsa or something in there? I don't remember the exact way that went. So, okay, what else is ketchup?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Is it also a juice? I mean...
Maybe?
Nah.
Wasn't wacky enough.
I mean, to be fair, I've heard smoothie and sports drink. I don't think I've heard juice specifically being mentioned. Sergey. Give me one thing that ketchup is, come on.
Sweet? I guess.
A vegetable! Yep. Oh my god, a spicy food!
What?
See, it's spicy, not just singular spicy, because if it was just one spicy, it would be mayonnaise. Because white people are whack like that.
What?
And yes, I know that I'm very, well, I look pretty red right now, but I trust me, I am white. Basically monkey. What? A compliment for hot dogs. A soda. The word I was looking for was soda, not juice. I should have said soda. Jam.
A jam.
Is ketchup is basically a monkey? Is that a thing? Because people googled for that, and then they googled for that plus the word meaning. So, vegan.
I'm gonna Google that.
Sergey, you are now part of the problem.
I know.
Huh. Vegan. I don't know. I'm just going to guess that regular ketchup probably isn't vegan. There might be eggs in there. I'm not 100% certain, though. And there's eggs and mayonnaise. I don't know. Honestly, like, listen. Is ketchup vegan is a very fair question. Next round. TV show about...
Time travel.
I like the way you think, but I don't think it's going to be a top result, but it might be a result. 3.
Hey!
You better say murder. Okay, there's enough TV shows about murder that apparently people don't care. To vote for this, perfect. It's okay.
Dinosaurs.
Let's go with dinosaurs. God damn it. dinosaurs. No. Robots. I'm gonna go with robots.
Yeah. Pirates.
Witches. Geniuses. Time travel. Airport customs. The Rock, aliens, okay, that makes sense, Jesus. Ferries. Plane crash. Missing plane. By the way, the show you're looking for is Manifest, and it's actually pretty good. Unless you're looking for the older, but also about it, well, the older one is, which is Lost, which is actually about a plane crash, while they're both kind of about a missing plane, though. No! I mean, it's probably all the services, right? It's like Maps, Translate, right? Like, Earth, right?
At least I hope so.
It says Google, I'm gonna go with Maps.
Yeah.
Should I just try all the ones that
Eight,
I said?
No, wait, six. Yeah, okay, sure.
Earth. And what did I say? Translate? Did I say translate?
Mm-hmm.
Second!
I think, maybe.
So it's okay, what else?
I had one. Docs.
That's a good one. No. Should I try Drive? I'm gonna try Drive.
Yeah.
No!
What the heck?
Okay, so I have one suggestion that I would want to offer, but I kind of want to have another one first from you.
I'm being really silly right now, but how about .com?
As in this, or as in an actual dot?
No, as that. But I don't think it's gonna work.
Okay. While I kind of sort of thought we might go something like Networth or whatnot, I have an idea. How about Feud?
Yeah. I like that.
No! News. Photos, flights.
Oh, photos,
meet,
right.
Classroom, right. Slides and Scholar. Yeah, I've heard of Classroom, I've heard of Scholar, I've heard of News, I've heard of Images. It's called Images.
Let me check.
It's Google, it's called Google Image Search. Also, I guess you can't go there directly from the main page, maybe. I mean, I guess you could, but... I wasn't gonna go with, like, images, because it's usually, like, the first, like, videos and images are usually the first suggestions. If you're in somewhere, like, you can tab into them when you search something, so I would never necessarily go there directly, unless I'm actually tapping in the URL.
No, that's something about... I think that's about the app.
Right! Yes! You can upload photos to Google. Yeah, I know, that's true. Do you want to do one more game? Like, three more rounds, basically. Three more queries, if you will. Is it okay?
Sure, yeah. I realize I couldn't search for that on my phone because I have disabled that app.
Okay, I went with people because, you know, what does your dog have? My dog has
asthma. I don't know.
Asthma, really?
I don't know.
I don't think so. I'm gonna go with lice.
Makes sense.
It wasn't it though.
Hmm. Hmm.
Heterochromia. I don't know. Huskies have that long.
What is that?
Two different colored eyes.
Oh.
I don't know if enough people know the term to actually Google it, though. But very common in huskies. They usually, oftentimes huskies have one blue eye and one brown, black, so like a dark eye.
That's actually pretty cool. But I don't think it's gonna be one of the search results. One of the top search results.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
Search queries, not results. Don't have like a couple of dog breeds have problems with breathing.
So should I try a cough? Or should I try
Breathing? Or trouble breathing, yeah.
What were you going to say? A problem?
Yes.
I think
though I don't know which term might fit better and what term people might use more often.
Trouble seems almost more natural in a way, and also it's shorter. So, I mean, also with a problem breathing, it also could be a breathing problem. So, I'm gonna go with trouble.
Makes
here,
sense.
But generally speaking, one word is usually better than two. Is the problem. My dog has. Sergey, do you know how to spell diarrhea offhand? Because that seems like a very valid thing.
And try. Let me see if.
you still Google search for diarrhea to just see if you spelled it correctly.
I almost got it right. I only had one R. You have to have two. And now H-E-R. H-E-A. Pronunciation.
Ayy! We got 19,000 points for that! Because apparently, nice. The second one also counted. Diarrhea, but it's acting fine. Which is, like, very specific. What else could a dog have, Sergey? I said lice. Maybe a worm or worms? I mean, probably worms as a plural. I know cats have...
Maybe?
I know cats have a lot of problems with worms, oftentimes. I don't know... Or generally parasites.
Wait, let me quickly translate something from German to English.
Oh, God. Sergey's going really hardcore into this.
Ticks!
Oh, ticks! Yes, sure, let's go with ticks. No, bumps yep. under... Bumps under her fur, specifically. A runny nose, okay. Dry, flaky skin and scabs. Dandruff. Crusty scabs on his back. Hiccups. To sleep touching me. A cough. So, right,
Yes.
When you said trouble breathing, I said, should I try a cough?
I remember.
Never put a.
Come on.
Cute robot. I don't know. Or other places if you have them. By the way, fruit are not meant for that. Please be careful if you do something like that, because that's not necessarily always good for you. Maybe use a condom or something. Like, seriously. Where was I? Never put a... This is weird, because I feel like there has to be multiple words, right? Which, again, makes the things difficult, usually. Never put a... What are we putting, Sergey?
But would it count if we just get the first one right? Like, with diarrhea? But is acting normal? No, fine.
I think the thing is, it depends. I feel like sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't, except partial ones. What can we put? Such a generic word, too. Like, put. You can put all sorts of things in all sorts of places. A grease fire out with water. I think that's how that works, right? You don't throw...
Seems... Yes.
You don't throw water on a grease fire. I think that's what you do. I don't think that's what people, like, are Googling for, especially because that seems like a thing you would either know or not. But,
Really struggling with this one.
Okay, so Nanas on pizza. Oh, wait, that doesn't work. That's German. It's pineapple. Fuck. I see, it's really funny in German, okay? See, I thought I was being clever there with like taking the first letter of the word being the A, but it's called a pineapple. Never put a pineapple on pizza. That doesn't sound right. Does it sound right?
No, it doesn't. Huh.
What are we doing? We never put a... cat in a toaster.
Don't think a cat will fit in a toaster?
Yeah, I didn't think so either.
How about a microwave?
I think it was cat in the microwave. Do you think people are going for that?
I don't know. I know it happened, but I don't think people Google for that.
Dude, I'm so confused. What are people Googling for? Never put a... steak in a toaster? Because it's either the best or worst that you have ever had. You must admit, it's like, as long as the grease is not
missing anything, yes,
it's probably a great idea.
I do like that, yes.
Don't try this at home, kids.
Like, even if it has a lot of grease, some fancy toaster have a thing to kind of catch the
crumbs, yeah.
The crumbs of the bread.
I feel like there's a reason why you shouldn't do this. I can't come up with it right on the spot. But also,
yes. I kind of think it's very specific again. And
so yay, we need to put something, right? I said the second round because the first one went by fast. I was expecting the second one to also go fast.
Should we just give up? Because I don't know anything. I don't have anything.
Listen, right? We're gonna get all the points! Okay, thank you, toaster was not one. But also...
what if it was?
Exactly, right? Never put a...
banana in your ear. I don't know.
Sure. Listen, right? We're gonna get one! I did it again. What else can we put? We could put a man on the moon. I don't know. ? Where God? Never put a ? Where God? Sock in a toaster. See, I was close! Hat on your bed. Man before your child? Okay, yeah, I can see that. Wig on your dog? Sure. Knife to Basil. Is this fair to know? Blade in the ground. Car battery on the ground. Genie on a budget. Woman on a pedestal. So this is about as weird and diverse and hard to guess as we thought. So in a way, our guesses feel less ridiculous now. Apparently sock in a toaster is a thing. My best friend is A. I'm going to go with psychopath. Sergey!
I feel called out.
Sergey. What in the world makes you think you're my best friend?
Makes sense. Okay.
if I wanted to call you out, I'd be like, right. So, okay, what could someone's best friend be?
An asshole. But mm-hmm. There's an A.
I was about to say grammar, an N. Right? Okay, so I'm going to translate. Yeah. This is something that starts, that would not start with a vowel, so... No.
Ooh.
Listen, right?
You disrespect people.
Okay, listen, right? This is about that cliche about vegans being preachy. I don't have a problem with people pursuing a vegan lifestyle. Just, you know, don't be an asshole about it. Okay. That was not the answer, though.
How about a dick? Or dickhead? Or something like that.
Richard. It's not Richard. Person.
Sounds a bit too normal for Google.
Yes, human music, my favorite. Man, woman? Do those make sense? Either one?
Yes, in certain contexts, sure.
Child? Because that would be kind of weird, given you are not one. Though, to be fair, I also thought...
Man-child?
What?
A man-child?
It seems almost...
That's a thing.
I mean, yeah, but that seems a bit specific, doesn't it?
True. Man, I don't know. That sounds fine.
See, I was gonna go with...
Sounds like something people would Google.
I was gonna go for idiot, but again, we have the grammatical problem. Vamp? Monkey, bag, narcissist, girl. See, I had something real bad. Guy. See, again, guy, girl, right? Like, people are worried about the gender of their friends, apparently. Nihilist. I mean, who isn't? Pathological liar. I was not that far off with psychopath. Marine. Shirt. I assume you want a shirt that says my best friend is a Marine. Which, I guess, fair. Right, I need to do this. Once again, we have proven that we don't know shit. So back to your regular scheduled program about us not knowing shit about artificial intelligence.
Humans
are not artificial intelligence.
Yes, but we also don't know shit about humans, as
well. We
just figured out.
Yeah.
In Google Feud.
I mean, I've said this before, right? The more search engines get friendlier to humans, the harder they get to use for me. I'm good at making machine-friendly queries. I'm not good at making human-friendly queries.
I can relate.
I'm also not good at the new kind of captchas. Which, once again, proves that I just might be a robot.
Yeah. But, regarding the human-friendly search queries, I did also notice that it became harder for me to Google shit over the years. And now that I've switched to DuckDuckGo, it is a bit easier, because DuckDuckGo still kind of uses more machine-like queries.
So, speaking of the fact that I might be a robot, Sergey, should I have human rights? Assuming the premise that I am, in fact, a robot, for argument's sake.
That is a very, very good question.
I know there's other things to talk about with super intelligent AI, but I mean, obviously, if an AI is at least as intelligent as a human, it kind of seems harsh to treat them just as a tool.
I feel like it kind of depends on whether or not they actually are conscious, if that makes sense to you.
Sergey? How yeah. do we determine if someone is conscious?
We don't know.
Great.
I think at least.
The closest attempt, something like this that we found, although I think it's more about an intelligence test, is the Turing test. I mean, that tests if you are human-like.
Yes, but that's not conscious.
Not really.
Consciousness.
No, I'm still curious about
what
would pass.
There are a couple of... What?
I'm kind of curious about what would pass the Turing test. Because, again, right, I'm good at machine things, I'm not good at human things. I kind of want to take the Turing test, okay?
The thing is, computers already are passing the Turing test, so...
Which would, I guess, make me feel even worse if I failed then, huh?
Yes. But, back to testing consciousness.
Yes, please.
There are a few tests that humans have thought of. Some of them are like seeing if one recognizes oneself in a mirror. This is one of the more basic ones.
Okay, but specifically for AI, it's not necessarily bound to a specific physical body, right?
Yes, that is a problem. Another one would be to recognize its own voice. Not as in a recording of one's own voice, because not everyone knows how they sound like.
Right.
But that they realize that when they speak, that it's them speaking.
Oh.
Which we don't even think about because it's so natural for us.
Yeah. I always love those things that are like natural to us, whether as humans or even just as people from specific societies. And all of a sudden we're like, oh, wait, mm-hmm. this is not a normal thing that everyone does. Like, whether it's on a yeah. other species don't do this or it's like a other cultures don't do this kind of thing where I always love bringing this up in like the language context, right? But it's like, we can't just take for granted that we have a plural singular distinction. And it's like, not all languages have a grammatical plural singular distinction.
Yeah.
Some languages have more, some have fewer, right? Like, it's kind of weird. Yes, you can have more distinctions than singular or plural. What do you mean you can't imagine that? Well, you know, it's a thing. There is dual, which means exactly two. And then there is stuff like, I forget, is Pockle few or many? I always forget, Pockle, I always get that. But there is, I think Pockle is a few and then plural is many, if you have the distinction there. So you can have, like, there is one, there's two, there's a few, there's many. And you can have all of those grammatically distinguished.
In Russian, kinda has a similar thing with numbers, where it is singular. It has a special form for 2 till 4, both inclusive.
Okay.
And 5 and upwards.
Okay, yeah, so that I guess that it would be a Pockle plural distinction, I think. Let's
maybe.
See. A Pockle number for a few as opposed to many instances of the reference. Yes. Pockle numbers has also been documented in some Kustanic languages of Ethiopia, blah, 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 blah. Of the Indo-European languages, Kurmanshi, also known as Northern Kurdish, is one of the few known languages with Pockle numbers, for instance, blah, 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 another, it can be applied to basically all nouns. In Russian, the genitive singular is also applied to 2, 3, or 4 items, making it effectively Pockle. There we go.
Interesting. The more you know.
magical number. That is not really what we're talking about, but I was just kind of saying, like, if you're a native English speaker, or German, or French, or Spanish, I think, Italian, right? Like, most Indo-European languages, right? Like, you kind of just assume that, like, okay, there's, like, one and there's more than one, and we kind of distinguish those grammatically. It's like, yeah, but A, you don't have to. There's a lot of languages that don't. And most Asian languages, I think, don't, for example. Or you can have more distinctions. And that is to say that, yeah, of course, like, if I'm talking, I hear my own voice in my head, right? Like, kind of, like, through the back of, like, whatever. Of course I do, right? And of course, yeah. I know, that's me that's talking. I mean, it would be kind of weird if I just heard someone talking, all of a sudden while I'm talking, it's like, of course. It's not a given. Another organism might not be aware if it's making sounds. Especially...
That is true.
If we don't know how much of awareness it has of the self. Or self-awareness. To use a simple term. And Sergey is still researching grammar notes about Russian, because we all know that Sergey doesn't really speak Russian.
No, I'm researching artificial consciousness tests.
Okay, fair enough. So, that is, also you could kind of make the argument of, I mentioned intelligence, intelligence level as a determinant whether something should have rights or not, but A, that would inherently suggest that children have fewer rights than adults, for example, because they're less intelligent, at least in a practical sense. They might have the same raw intelligence as a computing power, but if we were to measure their intelligence by any adult standard, they would generally perform very poorly. I mean, to some degree, they do have fewer rights, but so that is one of those things where also disabled people might have less cognitive ability, but they still have full human rights. Also, someone being a genius does not instantly afford them more rights. And so the question is that the standard we take? I mean, another moral standard people use is the ability to feel pain or something? Where it's like, it's morals are less about protecting intelligent beings and more about preventing pain. And if it's about preventing pain, then it only really matters. You only have moral obligations towards something if it's able to feel pain. If it can't feel pain, then you can't inflict pain on it, and so it doesn't really matter how you treat it. Kind of very broadly. Of course, if it could not feel pain, but it could feel joy, you could still inversely make the argument that lack of joy is still worse than having joy. And so you could argue that if an AI is intelligent but doesn't have emotions, it might not need rights.
Yes. Which might, I don't know, it might relate to self-awareness.
I was thinking that, right? How self-aware and intelligent can you get before it seems like... Okay, so I wonder if at some point in the process of being a self-aware individual, does having emotions become a necessary part, maybe? I don't think I word that well, but you know what I mean. Like,
I think I do.
Could you be an entity that considers itself an individual and is aware of itself as a being without emotions?
I think so.
I mean, logically, I don't see why not, but also it seems that...
I mean, like, a good but fictional example would be Vulcan.
Vulcans don't show emotions, but I believe they have them. I believe they just generally suppress them.
Well then, here goes my argument.
Let's see. Memory-alpha.fandom.com Vulcan. The Vulcans, or Vulcanians, were a warp-capable humanoid species from the planet Vulcan. They were widely renowned for their strict adherence to logic and reason, as well as their remarkable stoicism. That is not exactly what I would... brain? That's a huge passage about... I'm
pretty sure... searching for emotion.
I'm pretty sure there was a thing...
Just control F, emotion.
Yeah, emotion... The Vulcans were once an extremely violent and emotional people who waged almost... Yeah, right. They used to be very emotional. That's a thing. Is there something specifically in their culture or something? Naturally, the development of a Vulcan's lifelong devotion towards logic was encouraged at a very early age. Vulcan parents utilized careful and gentle methods to train their infants in primary logic. Vulcan children learned by example how to detach themselves from their emotions as well, and it often aided in difficult childhood situations. So, yes, they specifically just kind of are very stoic, but they do have emotions.
Okay.
I mean, there is definitely depictions, fictional depictions of AI where they seem like humans, but they don't have emotions. They seem like very logical humans. But, I mean, even the Vulcans, from a surface appearance level, seem to not have emotions. So, of course, at the end, they do. I'm just kind of questioning, on like almost a philosophical level, if it's a necessary component of being an individual. And I don't think it is. I would agree with you, generally speaking, but it seems interesting that every biological life form that we're aware of that seems to display some sort of self-awareness usually also seems to showcase reactions that could broadly be interpreted as emotional. Oftentimes having fear responses, for example. That, as a matter of fact, even ones that don't have self-awareness oftentimes have a fear response at the very least. They usually have the ability to feel pain.
Yes.
I don't know how, and they probably aren't as emotionally complex as humans, because I feel like that is probably somewhat related to intelligence in the kingdom Animalia, which is to say in animals. Though there is, of course, a lot of animals that are surprisingly intelligent. Pigs come to mind.
What about dolphins?
Dolphins as well, yes. I don't know that
much. Thanks for all the fish.
Yes. See, pigs come to mind because they're mammals as well. So they're, in a lot of ways, very similar to humans. And apparently they have very similar heart valves to humans. I believe that sometimes humans get transplanted pig heart valves if they have problems with them. I think that's a thing that we do.
That is interesting. I did not know that.
I think that's a thing. I feel like I've heard about that before. I didn't... Again, this... If something is mentioned outside of the Fact of the Week segment, you could damn well know that it's not fact-checked. And, at least you can reasonably hope in the Fact of the Week segment that we double-check something. I mean, if I... Let's see. Yep. There is... So there definitely seems to be a very common thing. Like, there's definitely results that suggest that it isn't, that is in fact something I'm remembering correctly. I didn't find any details on the go, but yes. Humans with pig heart valves are a thing. Because of course they are. Why wouldn't they be? So, I feel like we kind of went off topic with the whole AI thing.
Yes.
When would an AI deserve human rights, Sergey?
Probably when it's either self-aware or is able to experience emotions. Also including pain in there.
Yeah. I would kind of loosely have a similar idea. I mean, self-awareness in and of itself might not be necessary, but some like emotions or a survival instinct would probably be elements to look for.
Yeah.
The ability to feel joy or pain, or like generally positive or negative emotions. I mean, I guess there is no truly neutral emotion, so I guess it is all emotions, surely. Yeah, I was thinking about it. I couldn't come up with one out of hand. But
yeah,
I mean, there's probably some emotions that could go either way, but I can't think of one that's like truly neutral. But there's something there, though. It's still kind of, the idea feels weird that there might be an entity that you could have an intelligent conversation with that is, however, still a purely logical entity, and thereby we're not giving it any rights. It's, you know, the idea that, like, I could be talking to someone like I'm talking to you right now, and maybe they'd even listen. I know. You're probably looking up something right now, but so I could be talking to someone else right now, right? Like, and they might not be deserve any human rights by that metric, and it's like because they don't feel emotions, right? I mean, I'm not saying like a human being who has some sort of damage. I'm talking about like this entity that has a human level intellect, but doesn't possess any of the other stuff that comes with it, like emotions or survival instinct. And that seems strange. I'm not saying it's wrong. It just intuitively, emotionally feels strange. Because if you can have a conversation with it like a person, kind of feel like it's a person. And then again, humans, humans have a long and these are not so proud history of not treating other humans like they're humans, so I'm sure most people will be fine with treating AI like shit, even if they have emotions.
Probably yes, even if I don't like that person.
I've thought about that as well, right? Like, we clearly see a lot of, like, treating human groups worse because of certain elements, and I'm trying to think of what is something that we're currently not considering, right? Like, where is room for us to get better, right? Because, I mean, obviously there's still issues today, like racism and sexism to some degree. Homophobia is a big one, transphobia is an even bigger issue, where those are definitely problems we can still work on today. But I feel like I'm kind of already mentally trying to go over what are we doing wrong that nobody's even thinking about yet, right? Because it seems strange to think that we have all of our biases figured out, we have all of our discriminations, like at the very least, the most progressive among us, like, know where all of our issues lie. That seems a bit presumptuous. And so I was already thinking about, like, what would the next thing be, and I can definitely see AI rights being the next, if AI comes the way that it might, being one of the big ones that would come in the future. But I'm also thinking, is there any human group that we're not treating equally despite them maybe deserving it? I don't know.
I think there's always something.
You'd think so. I mean, I guess one thing that comes to mind that we're not necessarily talking about is nationality is a big thing still. Where we talk a lot about racism, which, I mean, race is a social construct. I mean, I guess nationalities as well. a lot of borders are as well. Not all of them, some of them are natural borders, but that still doesn't necessarily mean that someone's jurisdiction should end there or start. Just because there's, you know, a river or a mountain. But I guess that is kind of like the biggest one in a way, because obviously most nations treat people from other nations worse than their own people, which from a nationalistic standpoint makes sense. But kind of the concept of nation is kind of stupid to begin with, right? Like,
yes.
We're such a globally connected population, right? Like, having, like, in the Middle Ages, this probably made sense. I mean, there's still, like, the fact that they were fighting over territory and stuff is still a bit dubious, but obviously, at least on a continental level, especially, like, Americas and Oceania, where they're, like, not very accessible, of course, they need separate bodies in control of that, right? Like, we can't just have a global community when we don't have the ability to communicate globally on a somewhat instant scale, but these days when we can, it seems kind of arbitrary where some of our borders lie and how we treat, like, I feel like the refugee crisis in a way also illustrates that, where, I mean, people always say, talk about, like, racism against refugees, but, like, even if they had the same skin color as us, like, we'd probably still treat them worse because they come from a different country, right? It's like,
yeah. It is. It is what it is. And what it is not pretty.
Yeah. And then, of course, there's, like, issues with classism and people looking down on poor people, where often it's not even their own fault that they're poor, but different professions are looked down on and up.
Yeah.
I feel like the lesson of this is just that humans have a long way to go.
it's gonna take a couple hundred years probably.
Yeah, we'll probably be destroyed by AI
to fix
we
all, of that.
All of our bullshit.
And then we'll, yes, and at that point we'll probably have a list just as long as the current one with more issues we found in our society.
Yeah, it's like we finally figured out and like all humans are like truly considered equal and stuff and like and then it's like oh shit, we made human level intelligent AI and also we just encountered aliens. It never stops.
Yeah.
It's a fact that we'll have problems with aliens, right? Like, if we encounter aliens, we'll probably start a war. Whether they're hostile or not.
Yes.
Because we're humans.
Now that you say that, that makes a lot of sense. Like, I feel like the war would be started by humans, not the aliens.
Of course. Listen, right? Especially if aliens come to Earth, right? If aliens come to Earth, that means they're advanced enough that if they wanted us out of the way, they could destroy us without a serious war. If there is a war, it's because of us. And given that if there's an intergalactic civilization, if there's an intergalactic civilization, they could just go to an uninhabited planet. And if they needed more space, they could probably terraform it. If they need resources, they could just mine uninhabited planets. They don't need Earth. If they come to Earth, they probably come here for diplomatic reasons, and humans are probably going to fuck it up.
Yes. Oh, man.
We have wars with other humans, right? What do you expect?
True.
Like, the aliens will land, and first of all, that will be a huge international conflict no matter where they land, because they landed somewhere. Right? Unless they land in the Antarctic, which is like the most neutral territory I can think of, or like maybe international waters, and then somehow like the UN gets like a huge group of representatives to meet them, because that's the only like truly neutral way this can go. That's already going to be a huge conflict. And then even if the UN, for example, which I guess is the best body to represent the entire Earth, would decide to make peace with them, there's going to be at least one nation that's going to try to start war with them.
Yes.
And if they have oil, it's gotta be the States! Oh, yeah, how do you power your space force? Well, actually, use refined oil. Oh, you have oil! Don't you say, isn't there maybe someone we have to, like, liberate or something? We got very often.
I see my species in this picture and I don't like it.
Yeah. I've gotten very off topic, as per usual. Is there anything we actually wanted to say about AI still?
I don't think so. I think we've covered pretty much everything. At least all the basics.
If it walks like a human and it quacks like a human, give it human rights. Okay.
Yeah, kind of, sort of.
It's probably a duck. So, okay, what's your song of the week?
My song of the week is "Break My Stride" by Matthew Wilder.
Okay, I haven't heard
I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Probably. My song of the week is "Lonely Nights" by the Scorpions. Their memories all over the place, bringing it back all so clear. Remember all of those days, wishing you were here. And with that, if you enjoyed the show, leave us a like. if you have anything to say about artificial intelligence or the inevitable intergalactic war that was probably started by humans, will have been started by humans. Hey, there's a nice tense there. Then, you know, leave us a comment. Join the Discord server. I said last episode that I had a little card in the beginning, and it turns out I don't, because it looks stupid if I have that and the lower thirds. So, but there's still a link in the description. And did I mention to leave a like if you enjoyed this? Subscribe to this channel, which is TrashCanDV2, in case you weren't already aware of that. If you like Hearthstone, subscribe to TrashCanDV. If you like Beat Saber, subscribe to The White Shadow, that is Sergey. If you like D&D, subscribe to me. I make a video like every other year or something. And Sergey.
That's it.
That's it.